Good evening, and welcome to the 13th annual Esther C. Olin Lecture Recital Series on Piano Performance. Thank you for coming out this evening to hear Beethoven at 250, celebrating the piano as collaborative partner. Dr. Esther Clark Olin earned her Doctor of Musical Arts from Louisiana State University, Baton Rouge. She was a longtime adjunct professor of piano and music composition at Lynchburg College. She also taught music theory, piano class, accompanied senior voice recitals, and performed in numerous string ensembles as a violist for many Lynchburg College musical events. Dr. Olin accompanied her husband, Dr. Harvey Olin, in numerous community concert series, played viola in the New Orleans and Roanoke Symphony, and conducted the Loyola University Orchestra and Ballet Theater Ensemble. This lecture series, named in her honor, is an annual tribute to her musical legacy here at the University of Lynchburg. We are very thankful for this event. Tonight's performances will begin following a round of applause to show our appreciation for Dr. Olin. Thank you.
Thank you.
happy birthday. Beethoven is 250 years old. He was born in 1770. It is now 2020. He wasn't born until December, so we got this party started early. So you are probably going to run into numerous concerts throughout the course of this year, and you are probably going to hear a lot of Beethoven. So happy birthday, Beethoven. I figured that we would start today with an establishing context video. As my music history students know, I come up with very strong thesis statements. And today I would say that no one before or since has contributed as many significant works to the piano repertoire or become closer to capturing its soul as Ludwig von Beethoven. Let's take a look.
Ludwig von Beethoven was born to a musical family in Bonn, Germany, on December 16, 1770. At the age of seven, he gave his first public piano performance.
Beethoven's father wanted to make Beethoven into a child prodigy a la Mozart, but the whole child prodigy thing never really took off.
In 1783, Beethoven published his first work, Nine Variations on a March by Dressler. And in the following years, he continued to earn a living as a musician.
Since his father was totally irresponsible and there were two younger brothers, Beethoven helped to support his family by giving music lessons and also by playing in the court orchestra.
In 1792, Beethoven worked under Austrian composer Franz Joseph Haydn, and by the 1800s, his compositions established him as Mozart's successor.
When he was a young man of 25, 27 in the musical capital of Vienna, he had a blazing career as a pianist and also as a composer, and the two dovetailed because he wrote music for himself to play.
Although losing his hearing, Beethoven created some of his greatest masterpieces from 1802 to 1814, including the Appassionata Sonata and his only opera, Fidelio.
When Beethoven was in his mid-30s and discovered that he was losing his hearing, his musical style changed, and he wrote pieces that are often called his heroic works, like the Fifth Symphony and the Emperor Piano Concerto.
Starting in 1815, Beethoven's personal life unraveled, and his work slowed tremendously.
After the death of one of Beethoven's brothers, Beethoven succeeded in adopting his nephew, and there were tremendous court battles. All of this led to a less productive period in Beethoven's compositional output.
By 1819, Beethoven was completely deaf, but his composing experienced a rebirth, marked by some of his most renowned works, including the Missa Solemnis and his Ninth Symphony.
As the deafness increased to the point where he could no longer perform in public, he wrote pieces for a theoretical other, not for himself, and this was a big point of departure. He was writing for the future, and this had never happened before.
Beethoven died on March 26, 1827, and had a public funeral with over 20,000 people mourning his loss.
Beethoven's music, and in some ways his personality and the legends and myths around him, fundamentally changed really how we think about music.
Today, Beethoven's enduring work continues to be played worldwide, from the Olympics to films, and even during the fall of the Berlin Wall.
Beethoven was unique among composers of his day in that he believed that music had not only an entertainment value, but also a moral and humanistic value. His music was not only going to be enjoyed by people, but that it was going somehow or other to help humanity in some way to emerge from the darkness into the light.
Isn't he such a cute little boy? Look at those chubby little cheeks. He was the second of seven children of this family, but only three of them lived past infancy. He was born in Bonn, Germany. His grandfather sang bass and was eventually the music director for the court of Clement August, who was the Archbishop-elect of Cologne. So he was kind of like the big wig in the town, per se. Beethoven's father, Johann, was a tenor and friends gave violin lessons to earn some extra income. Their mother was a cook. Amongst his first teachers were, of course, his father, and then Christian Neef took over when he was 9 years old. He had an elementary education. His first composition, he peddled with it in 1778, and his, as we heard in the video, his first published work was in 1783. Practice, practice, practice. His father made him practice all of the time because they were trying to take him onto the road like Mozart, and that basically didn't happen. So Christian Neef, his teacher since he was nine, noticed that this child had a knowledge of opera literature and had this rare ability to open up a full score with all the different parts on it and play it underneath of his hands. That's how come he got that job when he was 13. When he was 17, he went to Vienna and he wanted to study with Mozart, but his mother got ill and he had to come back to town. So here he is, he's 17 years old. His world looks like this. French Revolution is going on at the time. And as I tell my students, they're 21, 22, they're gonna graduate from college. Many of them are gonna leave home so they can go and get their job. And Beethoven knew that if you were gonna make a living in composition, you had to go to Vienna. And I love this quote by Wallstein. You're gonna go to Vienna in fulfillment of your long frustrated wishes. The genius of Mozart is mourning and weeping because he's no longer alive. She has found refuge in no occupation with Haydn, and through him, she wishes to form a union with another, and that person is going to be Beethoven. So he leaves, he's 22 years old, he doesn't know a soul, he's gonna go and study with Haydn for a little while, but his reputation in 1792 prefaced him, and he first got to Vienna, and they were like, well, there's the pianist. Oh, he's a flamboyant young man, he's a showboat, he's untamed, he's not disciplined. But you know, he really didn't go to Vienna at the beginning to establish himself as a composer. He wanted to devote himself to studying and performing, and so he took lessons with Haydn at the beginning, but it was his improvisation skills that really whiz-banged people. As you see from the picture up here, you see Beethoven is conducting a small string group, Beethoven's playing at the piano. So in order to make it with the Viennese elite, with the patrons and the publishers, he had to perform in many salon settings like this. And that was kind of difficult for him because his personality wasn't one of those to do that. So by 1793, he's been there 1 year. He has established his reputation as an improviser in the salons of the nobility. Particularly noted for his power, his invention, his new ideas, and his improvisations. So within 2 years, he has premiered his first two piano concerti, and now his fame as a composer has begun to flourish. So what did he do? So he was influential in style and harmony, and all of that coincides with the development of the piano. It's different now. It's now getting 88 keys. These two piano pictures, when I was in Vienna, these are in museums, and I like the one at the bottom because you can notice it's got five pedals. So the piano is still under development at this time. We divide Beethoven's style periods into three parts. There's an early and a middle and a late. The early models are very classical in nature. He's using the same classical forms, but he and Haydn don't get along too well because I can only imagine Beethoven is like, but I want to do this. And the teacher's like, no, sonata form does this, this, and this, and here are the rules. And Beethoven wasn't about the rules. I could just see that right now. The middle period, as we heard on the video, is more like his romantic period, his romantic approach. It's the heroic era. And then at the end, he's refined that deeper level of communication within himself because he is totally deaf at that time. He challenged the harmonic conventions. He subtly changes harmony, which I think you heard that in the first piece. There are extreme dynamics. Joe Nigro describes it as, there's a soft and there's a loud. And when he writes two softs, PP, you better be very soft. And when he writes two Fs, you better be really, really loud because there's nothing in between. There's a lot of increased textures. That means there's lots of notes and fingers going on at the same time. And there are changes of a variety of moods. 1 minute he's happy, the next minute he's sad. And then there's that always that idea of let's make it up, let's improvise. There are 722 Beethoven works in total. 31 of them are instrumental works for like violin and piano. 10 piano trios, 8 chamber pieces, 7 works for piano four hands, and a lot of vocal works that I'm going to let our vocal specialist speak with you about. So tonight, we thought that we would talk about those chamber works where piano is supporting other soloists. And so here begins our discussion. I'm going to ask Jeremy Kraft and Johnson Scott, who's the interim chair of music, and Arminio Susana, who's the dean of Great Batch School of Music and Houghton College, and Noemi Lee. They're going to give you some of their thoughts and experiences about playing works of Beethoven. And so we're going to start with Johnson Scott.
Beethoven wrote a few works for piano four hands, but not so many. A few years back, I purchased the complete works of Beethoven on CD, and I received a box with 86 CDs in it. One CD has piano four hands. So apparently the other 85 weren't worth dedicating to the piano four hands. So he does have a limited repertoire for the instrument. So what is it? Exactly what it says. Four hands on the piano at the same time. Now, piano pedagogy is a portion of this particular series, and so we wouldn't be I would be remiss in not speaking about that. What is the opportunity for the student to play a piano four hands piece? Well, one of them is working with an ensemble, and so having the opportunity to understand what it's like to play along with someone else. It is not all about an individual anymore. Have to work together. Collaboration certainly works within that. The idea of making decisions and coming together to produce a piece of music with one other person. It increases your listening. Listening is one of the key things to playing with another individual or in an ensemble, in collaboration, so that you are creating the same effect at the same time. Even through practice, you don't work out every final detail. Sometimes that happens in the moment. And so we have the piano four hands pieces giving us that opportunity to experience that in a pedagogical approach. Now it's especially challenging due to the percussive nature of the piano. When I graduated from college, I came out with a degree in chemistry, which I have never used. But every now and again, I try to find a way that I can make my parents' investment worth the money. So 5 years in, I still look for scientific answers to my questions. And my thought was, why is a piano duet so difficult to do? And so what we're going to look at very briefly is a little physics. Waveform of C4, middle C, 261.6 hertz, if you care, played by various instruments. First, we're going to look at a flute. And you're going to notice that the flute has a little bit of a soft edge right when it starts. Just a little bit. Not quite as articulate as another instrument might be. We have the violin, and it eases into the note. Not that attack is not important, but it doesn't happen completely all at once. Trumpet. There's a lot of sound there, you can tell. It's pretty full. But you'll notice that opening is still a little bit smoothed off. Now let's look at the piano. Bam! It happens, and it happens immediately, and then decays off. So the piano is an unforgiving instrument when it comes to playing together, because it is a percussion instrument in this case. It attacks immediately, and so it makes the listener, the player, be a very good listener to make sure that they're lined up just right. That's not to degrade any other instruments, I promise you. Here are the pieces he wrote for piano four hands. He wrote variations, 8 of them, on a theme by Count Waldstein in C major. He wrote the sonata in D. 6 variations on Ich Denk Dein. 3 marches, 1 in C, 1 in E flat major, and 1 in D major. And an arrangement of his own fugue that he had written as opus 133, he rewrote again as opus 134 for four hands. That brings us to the piano piece you will hear for four hands tonight. From the 3 marches, the C, the E flat, and the D, published in Vienna in 1804. You heard earlier that Beethoven moved to Vienna because that was the place to be. He composed this in summer of 1803, which was after the Heiligenstadt letter to his brothers describing his severe depression and woe over losing his hearing. No doubt an incredibly devastating thing. He dedicated this piece to Maria, or the set, to Maria Esterhazy, and the sketches appear in the same document as sketches for his Eroica symphony, so we know that these were written around the same time. What you'll hear tonight is the E flat. Its tempo is vivace. We take into account when we set tempo frequently the fastest note. In this case, it's the 32nd note. The key again, E flat major. It is in ternary form, meaning A, you'll hear an A section and a B section called a trio, which is in A flat major, and then we do return back to the original. All have repeats, but characteristic of the style, we do not use the repeats when we play the A section the second time. So I'm going to invite Dr. Ramsey back to join me at the piano, and we'll play for you the Opus 45, number 2, Vivace, March in E flat major.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Jerry Kraft, and I'm the Director of Choral Activities here at the University of Lynchburg. And I have the great pleasure of talking with you about Beethoven's songs this evening. In total, Beethoven wrote 66 Lieder, or songs, in German. 59 of those were in the German language, and 7 of them were in Italian, and we assume that this is because his teacher, one of his composition teachers, was an Italian by the name of Antonio Salieri, who we might know as Beethoven's arch rival from that great movie, right? As Dr. Ramsey said a little bit earlier, we can categorize Beethoven's works as he transitioned us through the classical era into the Romantic era. And so many of his songs are much more classical than they are romantic, although in his nature, they are still experimental, especially with the updated piano as it is going on. He took the opportunity to write these songs in an effort to be experimental, except we also know that Beethoven didn't like writing vocal music. When we look at the output of some of the other composers of that time, they wrote many, many more than Beethoven did. However, his songs serve as inspiration for the generations that came after him in terms of musical style, in terms of composition, and many other elements. So this evening, I and my colleague are going to be performing Adelaide, Opus 46. We know it was composed between 1795 and 1796 with poetry by Matheson, who was a predominant poet of the time, and many composers used his text. Again, there's a very strong influence. However, the piece is very difficult to categorize as a song because it is, as one writer wrote, epic. It is much longer than a normal song. It is much more complex and diverse. And from the original poetry, which I'll read to you in just a moment, even though in the poetry, the name Adelaide is only stated 4 times, Beethoven uses this opportunity to really drive home the point that he really loves this lady. So, some interesting things about the composition as a whole. Some musical difficulties are hemiola. So this is where we put groups of 2 and 3 together at the same time. Sometimes it happens between the pianist and the vocalist. Sometimes it happens between the 2 hands of the pianist, which is always an interesting fight to see who wins, the right hand or the left hand. Vocal difficulties. This piece tends to sit for most people in an area of the voice called the passaggio, which is a very narrow set of notes in the middle range that are just really challenging. And Beethoven, in his way, just puts all of the most of the notes just right there in that difficult area. Increasing the difficulty are very long phrases, which we want to make sure to keep intact as best we can so that we really communicate the text. And the lack of patterns. In many Lieder, it's just repetition. You sing the same notes with new words over and over. You will not find that in this piece. While we say Adelaide 14 times, very little of the music is repeated. So I'm going to read you quickly the translation so you know what you were listening to. Alone does your friend wander in the spring garden, mildly encircled by magic light that quivers through the swaying, blossoming boughs, Adelaide. In the mirroring stream, in the snow of the Alps, in the dying day's golden clouds, in the fields of stars, your image shines, Adelaide. Evening breezes whisper in the tender leaves, silvery lilies of the valley rustle in the grass. Waves murmur, and nightingales pipe, Adelaide. One day, O wonder, upon my grave will bloom a flower from the ashes of my heart. And clearly on every purple leaf will gleam Adelaide. Please welcome to the stage my friend and colleague, Mr. Mark Craig, as we perform Beethoven's Adelaide.
Well, good evening. My name is Armenio Suzano. I am the dean of the Great Batch School of Music in Houghton, New York, and an old friend of Lynchburg College, but now I'm a good old friend from University of Lynchburg. How did Beethoven become Beethoven? How did his music garner so much reverence, appreciation, and even awe in the minds and hearts of people all over the world, from palace soirees and gala concerts in classical Vienna all the way to the spring and summer of 1989 on Tiananmen Square, China, when, united and invigorated against what they perceived to be brutalities of an oppressive regime, tens of thousands of students took to the streets and sang a song. They sang the main theme of a song they perceived united all freedom lovers across the globe and across time. What song was that? That was the Ode to Joy, sung on Tiananmen Square in 1989 from Beethoven's 9th Symphony. And I ask you again, how did that happen to one man's compositional output? Well, for starters, certainly not in a vacuum. Beethoven's originality did not come out of the blue, complete and untinged by existing music. Charles Rosen, the revered pianist and classical style scholar, reminds us that, quote, Beethoven's music is filled with memories and predictions, looking both back and looking forward. And of course, the trios being performed here tonight are a confirmation of that observation. First of all, Beethoven was just 27 years old when he penned the Opus 11. The clarinet, on the other hand, was a relatively new instrument. Haydn, who had been one of Beethoven's instructors, only started using clarinet in his own compositions about the time he wrote Symphony 101. And that happened only 2 years before his pupil Beethoven wrote Opus 11. So this is a very rare combination. To choose the clarinet and to insert this otherwise unknown, unreliable instrument into the precincts, into the sacrosanct company of the piano and the cello. Obviously, Beethoven is seeing something here. He perceives something that the average composer, and not only the composer, the average music critic, is not quite yet perceiving. In fact, this was so groundbreaking at the time that his own publisher said, you know, we appreciate you wanting to include this, what is it called, clarinet, is it? Just in case, how about you come up with a version for violin? Just so that he could ensure good sales and profits. And so Beethoven did. He came up with an alternative version for violin for Opus 11. So as you can see, Beethoven is treading on fields and paths that previous people had not dared going quite yet. And when the trio was finally published, the classically conservative critic of the Allgemeine Musikalische Zeitung found that Opus 11 was, quote, very difficult. And he actually took Beethoven to task for writing music that he considered, quote unquote, unnatural. Sorry, Clarinet, he did not mean it. What else is new? Well, if you remember the opening of Opus 11, which opened up tonight's program, the sprawling unison between the three instruments, the piano, the cello, and the clarinet. This was quite striking, and it has very little resemblance to the more analytical and rationalistic first movements of earlier chamber compositions. But Beethoven being Beethoven, there are many more striking and spicy touches to these trios. The exposition of, again, Opus 11 in the first movement closes in the dominant F major, as it should. He's looking back. He's being faithful to those who came before him, being faithful to the traditions. But then Beethoven slyly deflects the music to D major and G minor. And of course, by now you're thinking, okay, we're finishing F. Why is he going to D major and G minor? That's a good question that you ask, and I'm glad you do. And the answer is quite obvious. Well, D major is the parallel key to F major's relative minor, and G minor is obviously the parallel minor to D major's dominant key. Well, there you have it, right? Not quite. This is almost the same thing as saying, well, you are very closely related to your neighbor's best friend's brother's cousin's girlfriend, uncle, twice removed. Thanks, Beethoven. Finally, Beethoven attempts to rein in some of this more extreme tendencies that he's already brewing inside of his soul in his early compositional output. And how does he do that? He brings into the final movement of Opus 11 a wildly popular tune, which became the melody, the opening melody of Opus 11's last movement. And that was taken from an opera by Josef Weigels. It's called The Corsair. Again, purists at the time heard this, and they were up in arms with such a decision. And all of that came to a halt one beautiful and cold evening at the home of Count Moritz von Fries, when Beethoven decided to perform Opus 11 in a musical duel against the famous pianist and composer Daniel Steibelt. His rival challenged Beethoven head on, improvising his own variations of Josef Weigel's theme of Beethoven's Opus 11. Beethoven's reaction was furious. So he went over to the piano, took Steibel's score, placed it upside down, and hammered the music out with one single finger. And that assured that the result was a lifelong rivalry between Beethoven and Steibel. Well, I assure you that tonight's performance, both the opening Opus 11 and what you're about to hear, the piano score will be right side up. This is the minuet of Trio Opus 38. Would you please welcome for that performance to the stage tonight, my friend, Dr. They're coming. They're coming. This is Teresa Engel. And Dr. Lindsay.
good evening. After listening to a lot of Beethoven, now we are going back to a very early Beethoven in years. He was only 15 when he composed the piano quartets that I would like to talk to you about. The piano quartets are comprising the following instruments: the piano, a violin, a viola, and the cello. Somebody last week asked me if we are going to have four pianos on stage because it's a piano quartet. So just wanted to make sure that you're not expecting four pianos. We don't have that many currently on stage. So one piano, a violin, a viola, and a cello. What's interesting about these quartets, other than they were written when he was very young, first of all, you can see the WOO. Anybody knows what that means? It's actually a German abbreviation. It reads Werke ohne Opuszahl, which means works without opus number. Did you know that he has 205 works without opus number? First of all, you know that the opus number, he has a lot of works with opus number. But more, he has more works without opus number. 205. So tonight we are kind of taking up with the underdog, so to speak. We are playing something that wasn't perhaps thought of by even Beethoven that was worth giving an opus number, but we will definitely play one of these quartets for you tonight. So this piece was completed in, these three pieces were completed in 1785, and the different keys that you see listed. We have one in C major, another in E flat major, and the third one in B major is the one that we will play for you, excerpts of that piece. And they were published posthumously after the composer died, and for whatever reason they were given a different number. So the piano quartet number one in E flat, piano quartet number two in D major, and piano quartet number three in C major. The history behind these pieces, and let's talk a little bit about that. When you are a pianist and you would like to collaborate with string players, it's a very exciting undertaking, and it was very surprising to me to see how the genre was very rare up to this point. Really, so we're talking about 1785. Mozart wrote two piano quartets. He wrote one in the same year, in 1785, and that is the piano quartet number one in G minor, and then another one, piano quartet number two in E flat major, in 1786, just a year later. So one has to wonder, and these were the totality of Mozart's piano quartets. So what happened in 1785? Why did Beethoven write all of his piano quartets in 1785? Why did Mozart write all of his piano quartets in 1785 and then 1786? Interesting. And Beethoven did write another piece, a quintet for piano and wind instruments, which was opus 16. It was a more elevated piece. It got an opus number, which he then arranged for this instrumentation himself, which then was played also by a piano quartet. But other than that, Beethoven didn't write any other pieces for this genre. The influence on these pieces that Beethoven wrote, he modeled these quartets after a set of Mozart's violin sonatas. Another interesting fact that he thought to look at violin sonatas, to Mozart's violin sonatas, to model his pieces after. These violin sonatas were published in 1781. Just out of curiosity, I looked up, and I found out that Beethoven indeed met Mozart in Vienna in 1787. So he was 17 years old when he met Mozart, and allegedly he took a few lessons from Mozart. The C major work that we are not going to play tonight has some interesting elements to it. the C major work was in the same key and borrowing some thematic material from Mozart's Violin Sonata number 17, K296. And also, Beethoven later reused this material from the C major quartet into his early, two of his early sonatas, the Piano Sonata number 1 and number 3. Let's talk a little bit about the structure of the D major quartet. Three movements. One is Allegro Moderato, which we'll be playing for you. The second one will not be playing for you. It's marked Andante con molto, which means a rather walking speed, but a little more moving. And it's in F sharp minor, but the middle section in A major. And the Rondo, which is another fast-paced movement, the third movement, and in which this is the final movement with a theme introduced by the piano and repeated by the violin. And the episodes are contrasting and recall similar movements by Mozart as well. On a pianistic note, when I started working on these pieces, my husband, who heard me practicing, said, are you playing Mozart? So it would be interesting to see if you would think that this is really a Mozart piece, definitely an early Beethoven piece. However, one thing that Beethoven, an early 15-year-old Beethoven, didn't do so well for me as a pianist is that when he wrote lots of arpeggiated runs, some of them are kind of awkward. They don't feel so good as Mozart. So I am not going to blame him for that, but obviously he wanted to stir up some things and not be as conventional as Mozart was. You will see some contrasting dynamics that again they tell you a little bit about that late Beethoven that we see on the pictures of just a really passionate kind of morose person. But the piece is just really delightful. I'm sure you heard tonight, and when you think of Beethoven, you think of depression, of anxiety, of just I don't know what to do with myself sort of thing. And here's my music, this amazing heroic music. There was none of that in this piece. Sunshine, D major, happiness, delightfulness. So I would like for all 15-year-olds to be like that. That we know. Certainly, if there are anyone in this room, please do get inspired by that. And also, just the key of D major. Do you know of some of his works that were in D major later on that were perhaps a little famous? Anybody? How about the Pastorale Symphony number 6? That's in D major. Pastorale Sonata, opus 28. It's in D major. Everything that has to do with nature settings, gentleness, although in the Pastorale Symphony we do have a storm coming, but it's interesting that at 15 he didn't associate that yet with this key of D major, which Beethoven had a sort of a predilection for using certain keys for certain moods. E flat was always the heroic key for him. The C minor is a more grave, grave feeling. The funeral marches, the pathetic sonata, so on and so forth. So, D major, a very young Beethoven, delightful piece, and we're so glad to welcome on stage our string player colleagues. So thank you and enjoy the piece.
Thank you.
March 26, 1827. He had a lot of health problems at this time. They said there was a thunderstorm going on when he took his last breath, and they really can't land on the real cause of death. It could have been cirrhosis or hepatitis or lead poisoning or Whipple's disease. They don't really know exactly. We've already heard that over 20,000 people attended his funeral service. Franz Schubert was one of the torchbearers at this. He was a pivotal figure in the transition from the classical era to the Romantic era, and I think you've heard that tonight. And his influence on subsequent composers and generations was profound. Here are a few examples. Johannes Brahms, you have no idea what it feels like to hear behind you the footsteps of a genius like Beethoven. Richard Wagner, although interested in many intellectual pursuits, he decided in a career in music after hearing the classic works of Beethoven. Beethoven to the young Franz Liszt when he met them, "You go ahead, you are the one of the lucky ones. It is your destiny to bring joy and delight to many people, and that is the greatest happiness one can achieve." And Gustav Mahler was obsessed with Beethoven's legacy, and he declared that all of his symphonies was going to be like Beethoven's Ninth, and basically, they were. Piano-wise, he has redefined, he's developed, added pioneer, and provided many pieces a stark contrast. It's a wide array of pieces for amateurs and professionals, and they've never fallen out of favor. They've been played for the last 200 plus years. And there's a unique link between his love for solo instruments and the piano, and there's an incredibly rich repertoire that we can all pick from. We'd like to thank you for attending our lecture this evening. There are going to be snacks out in the hallway, and I'd like to invite all my colleagues back to the stage so that we can give them another round of applause. Friends, come back. Don't leave me here by myself. And they know they're coming back. That's the sad thing. Here are my friends. Bring that poster to you. Thank you guys. Have a great evening. Thank you.